A year of American literature. In this, the third quarter of American literature, we are going to contrast and compare realism and regionalism, which we studied second quarter, with modernism from about the time of the First World War until about the time of the 1950s. Many people use the term modern just to mean up to date, the latest phone, the latest styles. For this class, modern refers to the early 20th century. Modernists lived in a very different world than their previous generation. From wood-burning stones and a pump in the yard to gas stoves and indoor sinks. From wagons to cars, from steam locomotives to electric diesel, from dirt streets and wooden walkways to pavement, skyscrapers, trolleys, from frontier clothing, petticoats, to flapper styles, business suits. Remember, this was one generation, movies, radio, refrigerators, indoor plumbing, it's going to be big. Telephones, phonographs, electric razors, vacuum cleaners. Writers felt that their art should make a clean break from the past as well. So modernists developed a motto, make it new. If it looked anything like their parents' generation, they didn't want to see it. All of these changes brought about a variety of art. And yet, there are elements and themes that string them together, namely disillusionment, alienation, and experimental styles. Disillusionment. This was a generation that had gone off to World War I, sometimes joyously. When they arrived there and found the barbed wire and the trench warfare, their illusions were broken. They no longer believed in what they had been taught. Those who returned from World War I felt disconnected from people back home. People back home couldn't understand what they had gone through. Some of them didn't come home at all, but stayed in Paris. They called themselves the Lost Generation. The free-flowing alcohol and the easy morals of the roaring 20s offered lots of fun, but it didn't offer much fulfillment. This is also the generation that saw the Dust Bowl come in, destroy their farms, make them refugees in America. The generation that saw the stock market crash and the United States fall into the Great Depression. The characters in the fiction of this era mirrored the people of this era. They were alienated. Alienated is a feeling of being disconnected from society. Alienation becomes the strongest theme in modernist literature. Alienation can even be seen in some of their landscapes. From alienation comes the anti-hero. Let me explain. One of the greatest hopes of writers before the modernist period was that readers would like their characters and thus care about what happens to them. If they care about what happens to them, they'll keep reading. The hero of these tales would make choices that would make people in their culture proud of them. They may even save their world. Think of Huck Finn, Hawkeye, Odysseus, the anti-hero. Many of the characters of modernist writers were more like victims of their world than saviors of it. They may even utterly fail to understand their world. Think of Wing Biddlebaum from Sherwood's Anderson's Hands, or Walter Mitty from James Thurber's short story, or Phoenix Jackson from Eudora Welty's The Worn Path. These people are alienated. Now, don't confuse this with the Byronic hero. The Byronic hero is dark and brooding and misunderstood and perhaps a little self-destructive, but he's still admirable. He tries to do what's right. The Byronic hero was a creation of the Romantics. Don't confuse this with the anti-hero. Another way the modern era tried to make it new was with a new type of plot. Many new writers found that the traditional plot was too artificial, that background, rising action, climax, falling action, and finally resolution. Real life, they thought, does not follow this sort of pattern. They wrote stories with new structures. The two most successful new structures were the slice of life and a structure that revolved around an epiphany. Slice of life is a storytelling technique that shows the average day of a character. It's intended to reveal the character to the reader by showing what life was like for that person. It's not any story that has a life-changing event. It's an everyday sort of thing. Think of, for example, The Secret Life of Walter Mitty or A Worn Path. These are things these characters go through all the time. Another new plot structure was the epiphany. The epiphany stories don't have a plot climax of physical action, but rather they conclude when the main character has a sudden life-changing insight or revelation, a dramatic change in that person's outlook on life. Finally, we need to talk about the stream of consciousness. Some modern stories were written in a style that imitates the flow of thoughts inside a character's head. This appears as a chain of thinking that is sometimes connected and sometimes not, just the way a real person would think. Writers thought this truly put the reader inside the character's head. Stream of consciousness could be done either in the first person or the third person point of view, but was quite different from either the well-thought-out memoir style of the old first person or the storyteller style of older third-person narrators. During this modern era, the Harlem Renaissance occurred. A great outburst of music, art, and writing occurred in the Harlem area of New York during the 1920s. New African-American poets emerged. Their poetry could be influenced by the rhythms of jazz. Or by the rhythms of the African-American preacher.
I don't know what Terrell did. I don't know what Connolly did. But can I tell you what I did? I came to Jesus. I found in him a resting place and life.
A quick look at a few of the major books and why they are considered modern. F. Scott Fitzgerald's The Great Gatsby. A Midwesterner travels to New York City to make his fortune. Why it's modern? The main character ends up disillusioned. The novel portrays the corruption and hopelessness of the jazz age or roaring 20s. The main characters end up alienated from each other. The characters indulge in the corruption of the American dream, breaking society's rules and feeling restless. John Steinbeck's Grapes of Wrath. The Jode family breaks their tradition of farming and moves to California. Why it's modern. It portrays the harshest social injustices of the Great Depression. The characters become increasingly disillusioned as they first lose their homes and then suffer at the hands of the Californians. Modern life is itself the actual enemy. The characters find themselves lost in a world they never made and want nothing to do with. The Sun Also Rises. Soldiers released from duty after World War I go to Spain and watch bullfights instead of going home. Why it's modern? Because the soldiers are disillusioned and don't return home. The novel's filled with people that were lost and pretty much given up hope of being found. The people have fun in The Sun Also Rises, but that's about it. What's missing is the lasting sense of contentment or satisfaction with life. After the war, nobody seems to care about the things that used to be important. John Steinbeck's Of Mice and Men. A small, clever man teams up with a large, slow-witted man to survive migrant farm work. Why It Is Modern? The story emphasizes the desperation and isolation of migrant farm workers during the Great Depression. It portrays the deeper isolation and fear experienced by working class people who are disabled. In other words, everyone's alienated and disillusioned. In Zora Neale Hurston's Their Eyes Were Watching God, a woman grows up and learns about love. Why It's Modern. The main character and her husband, Tea Cake, are alienated from the mainstream African-American community. The African-American community is alienated from the white mainstream community. The main character breaks with traditional norms by marrying a much younger man who's not interested in social success. In Ernest Hemingway's For Whom the Bell Tolls, an American fighting with the Spanish communists during the Spanish Civil War must meld with a rebel group. Why It's Modern. The main character is searching for meaning in life. Caught up in the chaos and atrocity of war, Jordan's belief come under assault. His early idealism is shaken and sometimes lost in the face of reality. The structure of the novel is different from the traditional narrative form as the point of view shifts in the telling. Many American writers were influenced by three German thinkers. Karl Marx, who taught that life is struggle between the haves and the have-nots. Sigmund Freud, who taught that human behavior comes from unconscious interactions between parts of the mind. And Friedrich Nietzsche, who taught that the superior man has his own values, which affects and dominates others who haven't settled their own values, but have only herd instinct.